hey now, hear what I say now. Happiness is just around the corner. Don't know why I got that in my head. What is that, Venga Boys? I don't know. Anyway, I'm in my pajamas, and by pajamas I mean the sushi jumper that I wear to bed. Because I'm really behind on Vita. To me, not to you. I'm fine for you. But loads and loads of people over the last 6 months or so have asked me to make more videos on North Korea after the one that I made on my main channel. I'm assuming that if you follow this channel, you know enough about me to know that I have a dark fascination with North Korea. Not that I want to join North Korea or anything, but just I'm fascinated by the whole thing, the whole history. I know pretty much the gist of the history from like 1910 until now. And that's because I have watched so many films, so many documentaries, and also I've read quite a few books. I say a few, actually, I've only read 10. Like, that doesn't sound like many though, but there's a lot of words in 10 books. I'm on my 11th right now, but I'm not gonna spoil that just yet. Whoa. A lot of people wanted me to talk about the books I have read, whether I'd recommend them, and which books would help people get into the whole learning about North Korea thing. Personally, I would say if you want to get into the whole North Korea thing, watch documentaries on Netflix. Books are informative, absolutely, but make sure, I would just say it's easier to watch stuff to get into it. And then once you've got kind of a gist, or if you've watched my YouTube video on it, then move on to books. So if you've already done that, then this is the video for you. I'm gonna stop rambling, Jesus fucking Christ. So the first book about North Korea that I ever read was called Escape from Camp 14. It's written by Blaine Harden, but it essentially tells the story of a guy called Shin Dong-hyuk, I believe. Oh, hang on, is it? It is Shin Dong-hyuk. My God, I have no life. Also, disclaimer, I'm probably not gonna be pronouncing these names right. I'm sorry. It's one thing to read Korean names, it's another to pronounce them, all right? I will say with this book, disclaimer, there have been some queries about its authenticity, like the stories that Shin tells. I suppose his name would actually be Dong-hyuk because Shin would be the last name, but I'm gonna call him Shin anyway. I was actually recommended this by John Green. He made a video on Vlogbrothers talking about some books that he was reading. This is one of them, and I thought, that looks really interesting. Picked it up, haven't looked back. Essentially, this is a story about somebody who was born and raised in a North Korean prison camp. Camp 14 is basically known as one of the most grueling, torturous camps. If you're born in a prison camp, you're probably not gonna get out. You're probably there as a consequence of family members' past history. I'll just read the blurb, shall I? 27 years ago, Shin Dong-hyuk was born inside Camp 14, one of five sprawling political prisons in the mountains of North Korea. Located about 55 miles north of Pyongyang, the labor camp is a complete control district, a no-exit prison where the only sentence is life. No one born in Camp 14 or in any North Korean political prison camp has escaped. No one except Shin. This is his story. So obviously, he escaped. I mean, obviously, because he's written the book. He didn't write it, but you get my point. Basically, he was in prison and he met an old man who had seen life on the outside, and he tells Shin, like, it's amazing out there. You can have all the food in the world. Because he was born in this camp, he knew nothing about any kind of life he could have outside the camp. To him, like, the camp was his life. And he decided, well, I'm gonna go see it. And he escaped through, like, barbed wire and everything. And it's a fascinating story. Again, it's believed that he might have embellished some of the stories. Like, he allegedly snitched on his mum and brother when he found out they were gonna escape, and he watched them get killed, like, executed for trying to run away. So, you know, if you are able to overlook the fact that this story might be a little bit embellished here and there, it's fascinating, and it really got me into the whole North Korea, like, holy crap, what is going on kind of thing. It's a really, really good book. Blaine Harden's done another couple as well. And so look at, like, how water damaged this one is. I don't know why. There you go. The next one that I read is called The Aquariums of Pyongyang. This is by Kang, Chol-Hwan. Again, probably not getting that right. So basically, Kang Chol-Hwan was put in a prison camp at the age of 9. I might be getting it wrong, but I think it's something that his grandfather did. Might be wrong on that. I haven't read this book since, like, really early last year or the year before, So do excuse me, but I'll just read the blurb, alright? Kang Chol-Hwan is the first person to escape successfully from the gulags of North Korea and tell the story of his imprisonment. Kang exposes the appalling truth about life in the camp, the forced labor, the public executions, and the near starvation rations that drove him to eat bugs and rats. After 10 years, Kang was eventually able to escape via China to South Korea. This is another book that mostly details the torture camps. You know what? I just love my light reading on this channel, you know? It's not an easy read. This one does go into quite a lot of detail. But again, this was the first book about being in prison, so I'd recommend it, but it's not a happy story. But Kang Chol-Hwan now works for the Chosun Ilbo in South Korea, which is a really famous newspaper, and he's happy now. So that's good, isn't it? Oh, geez. The next book that I read is called Nothing to Envy, Rural Lives in North Korea. This is written by Barbara Demick. Barbara Demick is quite the writer, and she's actually done a lot with North Korea. Not with North Korea, but she's written a lot of pieces. She is a very, very good source for anything. Both Barbara Demick and Andrei Lankov are two of my favorite sources when it comes to news about North Korea. I trust their sources. I trust their opinions on things. And this book, if I recall, is a collection of stories. I believe there was one in this book about a North Korean doctor who's working in a hospital in Pyongyang. At least I think. I know it's about a doctor and they just didn't have any medicine. They didn't have anything to give people. This one might be a good place to start if you don't really know much about North Korea, because it's lots of little tiny stories that go through the famine that happened in 1994. It just talks about how the famine affected so many people, like millions and millions of people. Let me, do my bit. North Korea is one of the most repressive and secretive states on earth. Spying is encouraged, the media is government controlled. Gone with the Wind is a dangerous banned book. In the 1990s, famine descended. Indeed it did. Millions of people died, but the regime remained in power. Through extensive interviews, Barbara Demick has created the first portrait of life in this extraordinary country, weaving together the stories of six ordinary citizens in a gripping and vivid account of adversity and survival in the land of our dear leader. So it's six short stories, well, kind of short, you know, they're all kind of linked together. So this one might be a good place to start. You know, it's not a really, really heavy read about one person. It's very small writing though. Holy jeez. There are a lot of words in there. It's got a couple of pictures though. So, you know, if you're a picture kind of person like me, this is a very, very good book. I very much like this one. I'm sorry. The next one is called Dear Leader. This is by Jin-Sung. I had to remember that for a second. This one is another escape story, but I don't think this was about the prison camps. I believe this one, this is different because this guy, Jin-Sung, he actually worked for the Korean Workers' Party, which is the government, right? He was working on the inside, and I believe he was in charge of writing, I don't want to say press releases, but like propaganda for the North Korean government. And something went wrong. A document that he was trusted with went missing, and it had like state secrets on it and stuff. And he knew that if he was caught not having that document, if it was discovered that he had lost this vital document, he was going to be killed. So he was like, I'm getting the fuck out of here. Jang Jin-Sung was a high-ranking officer in North Korean counterintelligence, enjoying elite access to state secrets and praise on the President Kim Jong-il. Yet, when a forbidden document went missing, he had to flee for his life. Dear Leader gives rare insight into one of the world's most secretive states and just how hard it is to escape. You know, I can't remember what the document was, but it was very, very important. And he managed to escape, which, you know, is not an easy feat. There might be a few books about people escaping, but It's not a common thing, especially nowadays, since Kim Jong-un has been in power. They've really tightened, like, the borders and stuff. It's really sad. But this was a very, very good book. Very much enjoyed this story. Because this one's just, it's different, you know? It's not all about the prison camps and the fear of, you know, starvation, etc. It's about someone who was on the other side of it. Someone who seemingly had everything, and then things went wrong, and he had to flee. I would love to see a film made of this. Like, I think it's a terrific story. The next one is this one. This is North Korea Undercover Inside the World's Most Secret State by John Sweeney. John Sweeney works for the BBC, and he also did a documentary of his time out in North Korea. Personally, I didn't really like this. I think I gave it like a 3 out of 5 stars. This is a very biased piece. And obviously, like, you know, you're not gonna write a book saying how fantastic North Korea is. But I found with all of these books, like, they were kind of, they weren't biased. They, you know, they explained what was going on in a way that wasn't condemning the government and stuff. And I know that, you know, we should be skeptical of things and criticize things, but I just found it unnecessary in this book. I felt like John was definitely putting forward too many of his thoughts, and it kind of just, you know, you're talking about brainwashing and stuff, and then it felt like fear-mongering in this book. I mean, definitely pick it up if there's no other book, and also if you can handle, like, someone sort of using terms that are meant to evoke emotion in you rather than just explaining fact. Overall, it was, like, a really good book in terms of the story. Basically, there was a documentary, which you can find on the BBC, I think. I think it was Panorama or something. John Sweeney went into North Korea pretending to be, pretending to be a teacher, I think. Yeah. Posing as a university professor, award-winning BBC journalist John Sweeney travelled undercover to gain access to the world's most secret state. Drawing on his experiences and extensive interviews with defectors, commentators and key witnesses, North Korea Undercover pulls back the curtain, providing a rare insight into life there today and addressing important questions about the regime's uncertain future. Basically, he pretended to be a professor, got a tour of Pyongyang, got to see, like, the hospital that didn't really have anything going on. You know, he questions whether it was, like, set up and, you know, people were posing. It was okay. Like, there's a lot of facts in this as well, but I just found the opinion stuff a bit... The next book I'm going to share with you is extremely fact-heavy. This is not so much an account of someone's experience with North Korea, but it is... It basically... This is the book that taught me most of what I know. I will say that even though I own the physical of this, I did actually listen to the audiobook. That is actually how I got through the whole book. I'd play it in the car when I had long journeys and stuff. This is a very, very heavy, intense read slash listen. It's called The Real North Korea by Andrei Lankov. Obviously, like, Andrei Lankov is, like, the number one source for me. Like, he's a professor in Russia, I think, teaching about North Korea. He is a very, very, very smart man. And any documentary that has Andrei Lankov interviewed for it, I just think, yes, okay, you've done your research. In The Real North Korea, Andrei Lankov substitutes cold, clear analysis for the overheated rhetoric surrounding this opaque police state. After providing an accessible history of the nation, he turns his focus to what North Korea is, what its leadership thinks, and how its people cope with living in such an oppressive and poor place. He argues that North Korea is not irrational and nothing shows this better than its continuing survival against all odds. A living political fossil, it clings to existence in the face of limited resources and a zombie economy, manipulating great powers despite its weakness. Even though its leaders preside over a failed state, it has successfully used diplomacy, including nuclear threats, to extract support from other nations. But while they've been ruthless and successful in holding on to power, the old system is slowly falling apart. In the long run, with or without reform, the regime is unsustainable, and reforms, if attempted, will trigger a dramatic implosion. That's just the blurb. That's what's supposed to be the simplified version to get you to read the book. If you want to study North Korea, and the history of it, and what's actually going on in the country, anything political to do with North Korea, just read this, and you'll know it. You know, I would be executed for doing that. I'm so sorry. Genuinely, I would, like, if I was in North Korea and I did that, I would be, like... But it's a wonderful, wonderful book. It's not biased, it's so heavy, so informative. It's just fact after fact after fact. Cannot recommend this enough. I'm actually gonna re-listen to the audiobook, I think, because it's been a long time since I listened to it, and I think I need to top up my knowledge. The next book I'm gonna share with you is probably my favorite of all of the ones I've read. This one is, it's another escape story, but it's put across in such a heartbreaking way. It's called In Order to Live by Yeonmi Park. Now, Yeonmi Park has become somewhat of a celebrity. You might have seen that really viral Facebook video of a girl in a traditional kind of gown with her hair up, crying about how she escaped. That is her. Look how different she looks now. This is her story. She wasn't in a prison camp, but she did defect. And I think she was like 13. This is so heartbreaking. I will say again, apparently there have been some queries about the accuracy of her rendition of events, but regardless, this is such a sad tale. But it's also one of hope, you know? Like, she was 13 years old. At least I think she was. Let me read the blurb for you. I wasn't dreaming of freedom when I escaped from North Korea. I didn't even know what it meant to be free. All I knew was that if my family stayed behind, we would probably die from the inhuman conditions of a prison labor camp. Though she wasn't in a labor camp. Maybe I was wrong.
The hunger had become unbearable. I was willing to risk my life for the promise of a bowl of rice. But there was more to our journey than our own survival. My mother and I were searching for my older sister, Yeonmi, who had left for China a few days earlier and had not been heard from since. Along my journey, I have seen the horrors that humans can inflict on one another, but I've also witnessed acts of tenderness and kindness and sacrifice in the worst imaginable circumstances. I know that it's possible to lose part of your humanity in order to survive, but I also know that the spark of human dignity is never completely extinguished, and given the option of freedom and the power of love, it can grow again. This is my story of the choices I made in order to live. Get this book. Honestly, you know what? Start with this one because it will hook you on just how harsh the conditions were for all of the defectors and how much better their lives have been since they were able to escape. It's a very, very good book. It's kind of a goal of mine to meet her and just talk to her. But I mean, also like, you know, I don't know if she'd want to constantly go on about the things she's been through, but I know that my friend Hannah has met her and I was so jealous. Inspiration, amazing lady. Next up we have 1,000 Miles to Freedom by Eunsun Kim. This is quite similar to the last one. Obviously their stories are very different, but it's also a tale of escape by a young North Korean lady. This one though, I remember being so, so sad. Like I felt like this one was just so hard to read. I'm pretty sure she escaped through Mongolia. This one, she escaped through Mongolia, not through mainland China. And she was 11 years old and it took her 9 years. 9 years! There were some horrible things. I'm pretty sure she had to witness some horrible things happen to her mother, and it's not an easy book to get through. Actually, like, it's, you don't want to put it down, so it's easy to read in that sense, but the topic is just so sad and, oh. Allow me to read the blurb for you. Eunsun Kim was born in North Korea, one of the most secretive and oppressive countries in the modern world. As a child, Eunsun loved her country. Despite the school field trips to public executions, daily self-criticism sessions, and the increasing gnaw of hunger as the countrywide famine escalated. By the time Eunsun was 11 years old, her father and grandparents had died of starvation, and Eunsun was in danger of the same fate. Finally, her mother decided to escape North Korea with Eunsun and her sister, not knowing that they were embarking on a journey that would take them 9 long years to complete. Before finally reaching South Korea and freedom, Eunsun and her family would live homeless, fall into the hands of Chinese human traffickers, survive a North Korean labor camp, and cross the deserts of Mongolia on foot. That's ridiculous, isn't it? Like, it really puts into perspective, like, how lucky we are. Just, oh. She has gone through so much. I complain when my Wi-Fi dies. Next, we have The Girl with Seven Names by Hyeonseo Lee. Sorry if I'm pronouncing that wrong. It's another escape story. I don't like, you know, saying, oh, it's another one, just the same, because every story has been lived by someone. Like, every one of these people has gone through all of this stuff. You may recognize this lady from a TED talk that she did. If you want to get the gist of her backstory before starting this book, you can type in her name. And then the TED Talk should come up. I'm pretty sure I read this one in maybe about 2 nights, I think it took me to read this. I just could not put this one down. It was so, the story is so well told. And the whole Seven Names thing is because she had to go by so many aliases and false names, have false identification passes in China. That's why she had seven names, and it's just. As a child growing up in North Korea, Hyeonseo Lee was one of millions trapped by the world's most secretive and brutal communist regime. From the indoctrination she received in kindergarten to her forced service in the Socialist Youth League at age 14, I really can't read tonight. The state controlled every aspect of her life. When the Great Famine struck in the 1990s, and she witnessed the chaos, starvation, and repression all around her, she began to doubt her longest held belief. Was her country, as she'd always been told, the best on the planet? In 1997, aged 17, Hyeonseo Lee escaped North Korea for China. Her mother's first words over the telephone to her lost daughter were, "Don't come back." The reprisals for all of them would have been lethal. The Girl with Seven Names is the story of Hyeonseo's life in North Korea, her escape, and the courage she found as a lonely, vulnerable teenager to make a life for herself in China. She has gone through so much, and it's a really sad story. I don't want to say, like, it's a wonderful story, even though it is in terms of the way it's told. Just Just read this book, please. It's very, very good. Next up we have Without You, There Is No Us, and this is by Suki Kim. This is the last one that I've read all the way through. This is not an escape story. Suki Kim was offered an opportunity to teach at Pyongyang University, where she was teaching English to the sons of, like, the most well-off, privileged people in North Korea. She tells her experiences of what it was like teaching out there and all the questions that they would ask her. And of course, this is a country that doesn't have a religion. Religion is, they say that you are allowed to practice a religion, but essentially, like, your religion is the Kim dynasty. And a lot of the teachers at the university were coming over from, like, America and England, etc. And a lot of them were religious and they had to kind of hide it. And it's very, it's a really, really fascinating story. I wouldn't say it was the best in terms of storytelling. I can't remember what it was about this, but it didn't grip me in terms of the writing, and also some parts kind of dragged on a little bit, but overall it's obviously different to a lot of the escape stories, and it was definitely worth reading. I don't regret reading it at all, but it did take me a good couple of weeks to get through it. Three times a day the students march, singing praises to President Kim Jong-il and North Korea. Suki Kim soon learns the tune. It's 2011 and she's accepted a job at the Pyongyang University of Science and Technology, teaching English to the sons of the elite. The boys are obedient to the nation, yet seem curious at Suki's hints about the West. Without You, There Is No Us offers a moving and rare glimpse of life inside the world's most inscrutable country. I'm pretty sure I found out about her because there was a TED Talk that she did, and also it was set to music, and it was really weird. Like, I'd never seen a TED Talk that had backing music before, but still, very interesting, just it's kind of hard to get through. Hey, it's Emma from the future. I'm about to rush out, but I'm putting this in here because I forgot an audiobook that I listened to a long time ago. It's called Under the Same Sky by Joseph Kim. It's another escape story, but this one was more about, like, starvation, and this one was very, very tough. I know that they're all difficult to listen to or read, but this one was very, very heartbreaking. But essentially, one of the reasons that I really wanted to mention this one is because at the age of 16, Joseph Kim was living in hiding in China. Like, by the way, I think most of you know this, but if you're a North Korean refugee and you're caught in China illegally, you're sent back to North Korea. What do you think happens to you? So refugees have to live in hiding, in fear every day that they're gonna get caught. And it was actually thanks to Liberty North Korea, our babes, and they actually helped to rescue him. They got him out of China and gave him a brand new life. It's definitely a story of struggle and eventually hope. And it's actually one of the main reasons that I love talking to you guys about Liberty North Korea, because the book is proof that they changed lives, you know? If it wasn't for Liberty North Korea, we wouldn't have that book. And thanks to all of you guys donating to Liberty North Korea, as well as helping us raise $10,000 thanks to the Project for Awesome thing. In the future, we might get more stories, you know? We might find out a bit more about what's happening in present day North Korea under Kim Jong-un because of the refugees who will be rescued by Liberty North Korea. So just wanted to mention that. It's a really great book. Enjoyed it. Well, enjoyed it in a storytelling sense. You know what I'm saying, okay? I also read another one. It's called The Orphan Master's Son. This is a fiction book about North Korea and it sucked donkey dick. I hate it and I didn't finish it because it was just really, thought I'd mention it. That book got, like, rave reviews by everyone. I thought it was dog shite. Anyway, back to past Emma now. And finally, we have the book that I'm currently reading, as you can tell by my makeshift paper bookmark. This is called A Kim Jong-il Production, and it's by Paul Fischer. I recently watched a documentary that was on BBC about this very topic. I'm pretty sure it will still be on iPlayer. If you live in the UK, you might still be able to watch it. So I have kind of spoiled, like, what happens by watching that. But this book tells the story of a kidnapping. Well, two kidnappings. By Kim Jong-il, you have two South Korean people. One of them is a very, very famous film director called Shin, and his wife turned ex-wife, Choi, who Shin put as the leading actress in all of his films. Like, their films are really, 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 really famous in South Korea. Kim Jong-il in North Korea was a massive film nerd. He loved films. And he decided that he wanted North Korea to be known for making amazing films as well. So what better way than to just kidnap Shin and Choi from South Korea. Pretty sure they were kidnapped in Hong Kong or off the shore of Japan. I should know, I'm reading it. But Madame Choi was kidnapped first, and then Shin was kidnapped a short while after. And this tells a story of what it was like being treated by Kim Jong-il. Like, apparently he was very, very lovely to them and spoiled them. Shin tried to escape a couple of times, I believe. Like, as far as I've got, he's already tried to escape once. And then both of them were kind of forced to make films in North Korea. And they actually produced the most famous North Korean films out there, The Flower Girl, and I think, what's the other one called? Pulgasari? Pulgasari? Something like that. It's basically a North Korean Godzilla movie. Pulgasari, I think is what it's called. Eventually, spoiler alert, I'm sorry to spoil it, they do both escape and make their way back to South Korea. I haven't got that far, but I watched the documentary, and if I can't live spoiler-free, you don't get to either. So far, it's very, very good, although I've been reading this for about 3 months now. It's just picking up, and we're halfway through. It is taking a while to get into the story. I feel like there's a lot of unnecessary information in this book. I feel like there's just bits where I don't need to know all of this backstory. But it does get you invested in the characters, and I say characters, people. They're real people. This happened. Kim Jong-il literally kidnapped a film director and an actress who are really famous in South Korea. But it is very interesting, and once I've stopped filming, in about 2 minutes, I am gonna go and get in bed and carry on reading it. So those are the books that I've read. I have another like 10 downstairs. There's some about the Korean War. I don't know much about the Korean War, so I need to read that. And then there's a couple of more escape stories somewhere. But yes, this is my weird, strange, dark, fascinating hobby. If you'd like to know more about North Korea, or at least the basics of it, I made a video of my main channel. And if you would like to do a little bit of good in the world today, then you can donate to Liberty North Korea, who are a charity who help to rescue North Korean refugees who have fled into China. None of that money goes towards the North Korean government, it just, they help to find people who have already escaped and who are living in hiding, and then give them a new life. Anyway, I hope you found this somewhat helpful. I know I went on for a very, very long time. I'm gonna go because it's midnight and my speech is doing that thing where it just stops working. I will speak with you all tomorrow.